Welcome to Intuition. Let's continue discussing basic issues in atmospherical physics in relation to climate research over the past century that you may or may not know, but would be delighted to watch this short talk. Manabe, a well-trained computational meteorologist who had been in USA for over 60 years, remained unknown to most of the people in the world until 2021, when the Norwegian Nobel Committee called him that he got a Nobel Prize in physics. How could a meteorologist win a Nobel Prize in physics? What was his original work that is comparable with the discovery of quantum mechanics, if there's any? Today, I'm going to give a first talk as an introduction on Manabe and his climate modeling, for which he has become famous. Please like, make comments, the more the better, and subscribe, as well as activate your bell so that you wouldn't miss any new progress in my research and unexpected drama. I think the YouTube algorithm will be delighted too. So, are you ready? Let's go and have fun. I have been investigating several papers by Manabe in the 1960s for many years, so I was not completely surprised when the news came in the current climate. In 1967, he and Wetherald predicted by numerical calculation that CO2 concentration doubling can cause both the stratospherical cooling and the global warming near the surface between 1.3K and 2.3 Kelvin, depending on water vapor distribution in the atmosphere. So far, their results have been adopted by the IPCC and many climate researchers as a kind of axiom or the standard to describe the CO2-caused global warming by humans, although the results were calculated for sure. How did he do that, you may wonder? Unlike Arrhenius, who simplified the real atmosphere as a single layer of water vapor and CO2 above the surface, Manabe treated atmosphere as a multiple isothermal layer, a dozen or so. In this way, the vertical temperature distribution could be investigated from the surface up to the middle of the stratosphere. No doubt, Manabe's multi-layer models is more realistic than Arrhenius, but his idea was not original. In fact, as one viewer drew my attention, Sir George Clark Simpson, an esteemed meteorologist, had introduced a multi-layer atmospheric model as early as 1927, focusing on water vapor radiation. Still, Manabe was the first to claim that convection could be incorporated into his radiative transfer calculation, while Arrhenius only considered radiative equilibrium. Again, you may wonder, how did he do that? First, he divided all of his radiative layers into two types, convective and non-convective. For convective layers, the local thermal equilibrium temperature of layer can be achieved when the radiation cooling is equal to the convection warming. For example, a layer within a troposphere at a certain temperature would be getting colder if it emits infrared, but it also could be warmed up by hot airflow brought up by convection. Do you know what I mean? So, eventually, the local temperature of this layer, called the local equilibrium temperature, LET, can be achieved. Sounds reasonable. I thought so, but I have become skeptical now. How come? Well, let's consider the radiative and convective balance at the surface first. As a passionate believer of the greenhouse effect hypothesis, Manabe argued that the convective thermal flux is determined by the difference between the solar radiation intensity at the surface and the net infrared radiation by the surface, namely I convective equal to I solar minus the net infrared radiation. On the left-hand side, I convection represent the convection flux. On the right-hand side, the first term represent the solar radiation at the surface. The third term is a long wave radiation by the surface, presumably. And the third term is downward or back radiation by greenhouse gases. Using the IPCC's latest global energy budget diagram, this balance equation at the surface can be written in numbers in unit watt per meter square. So the convection heat flux at the surface is dependent of the back radiation by the trace greenhouse gases from the atmosphere, which is as strong as average radiation by the sun at the top of atmosphere, which is a joke. If you think I'm wrong, why don't you take off your clothes and stand outside at night, expecting your skin would be burned by the strong back radiation? Try it. In passing, it seems important to point out that such unconditional convection heat flux, 105 watt per meter square, is almost identical to the sum of the so-called sensible heat and latent heat in this IPCC's energy flow diagram, here as you can see. In other words, both thermal conduction and the evaporation at the surface are facilitated and eventuated by the convection. But did the ICCP deliberately make the convection invisible in this diagram for the public? Perhaps they don't want people to know Manabe's convection at the surface, 105 watt per meter square, is unrealistically small compared with the assumed surface infrared radiation over 390 watt per meter square. Now, a thought experiment. If all of the so-called greenhouse gases, water vapor, CO2, ozone, oxfat, and so on, were completely removed from our atmosphere, what would happen? Using Manabe's boundary condition at the surface, the convection heat flux must be negative 237 watt per meter square in order to maintain the surface infrared radiation at over 390 watt per meter square. In fact, I encountered this number when I wrote my first paper on climate, but I couldn't explain it properly until recently. Of course, this is impossible because the atmospheric temperature should be much hotter than the surface. How could the surface still radiate when it is colder than its environment? This implies that the so-called radiative and convective equilibrium formulae used by Manabe and Wetherald in 1967 to predict global warming by CO2 cannot be self-consistent. I can talk about more detail about my analysis on their work in the future. Notice, however, that all of the nonsense and the theoretical inconsistency disappear once we assume there is no black radiation by the atmosphere, there is no infrared radiation by the surface. That's to say, the convection mechanism can sufficiently transfer the solar radiation at the Earth's surface into the internal thermal energy of the atmosphere, irrespective of whether there is any CO2 around. Why am I so confident to say so? Because, as I told you, I have found recently the radiation imbalance at the stratosphere due to CO2 concentration doubling was overestimated by Manabe and Wetherald by a factor of 3. Even we use the value 3.7 watt per meter square endorsed by the IPCC. If you feel a little bit surprised by my analysis, then you might be interested in this question I asked myself. What has been Manabe's opinion on climate modeling in his entire research career? In other words, how did he evaluate his contribution to climate research? If we just listen to what Freeman Dyson said about this American-Japanese computational meteorologist, then we might have thought Manabe seems not so keen about his predictions by using computer modeling.
So anyway, Manabe always said, and still he says, that these climate models are excellent tools for understanding climate, but they're very bad tools for predicting climate.
Apparently, Dyson must have discussed the computer-based modeling with his personal friend Manabe, and he might have had an impression that Manabe didn't consider computer modeling is reliable, but just as a powerful diagnostic tool, because that is what Dyson's consistent opinion on future prediction.
Yes, and you just cannot model everything. It's way, way out of sight.
Nevertheless, if we also listen to what Manabe had said on several occasions over the past decades, then we could smell something different from what he might have told Freeman Dyson.
We are quite certain that model can reproduce the climate change, not only in the immediate past, but also in future.
It could be argued that Manabe has been motivated by his belief in Arrhenius' climate model, although he blamed those heretics. Merely rely on their believed ideas without doing their homework properly. Did he include his friend Freeman Dyson? I wonder if Manabe had paid more attention to the general circulation rather than blindly believe Arrhenius' radiative climate model. Would he still have made such fundamental mistakes in formulating the convection and unrealistic stratospherical cooling? Because he might have found nothing is wrong about the greenhouse effect hypothesis, he gladly accepted the claim that his prediction in 1977 for the global warming due to CO2 have been confirmed by observations. While he also acknowledged there are large uncertainties in his climate models. In fact, it is due to his remarks that the basic idea, experiment, and observation have been redefined in the climate research community. It would appear doing computer modeling is equivalent to doing an experiment, while comparing more than two computer simulations is called intermodal observations, which has nothing to do with real experiment observation at all. Above all, he has seriously thought, with the advent of more and more advanced computer technologies, the future climate can be predicted by simulations. Is this the reason why the Norwegian Nobel Prize Committee considered Manabe's work as an outstanding contribution to physics since Galileo and Newton, although Manabe has been installed as the new father of the climate science to replace the senior Arrhenius? He was not invited by this nanny of the Nobel Prize winners. Instead, Manabe was merely portrayed as a fairy tale as a visual introduction to the program called the Nobel Minds 2021. Incidentally, it would appear the Norwegian Nobel Prize Committee had to wait years until Freeman Dyson finally couldn't speak out anymore before they informed Manabe that he was a winner.
Yeah, I never thought that.
For those viewers who are unfamiliar with Freeman Dyson, here is a brief introduction. In 1949, Dyson first proved that the two seemingly different theoretical descriptions of quantum electrodynamics, known as QED, are mathematically equivalent. As a result, Feynman, Schrödinger, and Tomonaga share the Nobel Prize in Physics in 1965. In short, Dyson had acted as unparalleled, satiric, and subversive heretic until his death in 2020.
And the same is true of climate, that there are all sorts of things we can do in a practical way. It's not only we don't only have to worry about warming, we also have to worry about cooling, and it could very well be the climate gets colder. Nobody knows.
Should I say, Dyson had kept Manabe relatively tamed until the Wuhan virus showed up.
Well, 98% scientists, they talk a lot of sense, and the 2%, they talk a lot of nonsense.
Who is this guy? He's Klaus Hasselmann, who shared the Nobel Prize with Manabe, who has been also passionate about the greenhouse effect hypothesis. I will talk about him soon. Please stay tuned. Thank you for viewing. Thank you for donation. See you next time.